Most of us know that the software project management method waterfall doesn't work for a lot of projects. Today, I want to share three models that help explain why waterfall doesn't work. The three explanations are: 1, that we specify most of the requirements when we know the least; 2, that most of the systems that we build are E-type systems; and 3, that most of the problems that we face are either complicated or complex in the Stacy matrix. Let's go! Let's first look at this simple graph. On the x-axis we have time, and on the y-axis we either have requirements, which is this red line, or we have knowledge, which is this blue dotted line. So what does this say? This says that in the beginning of the project, when we're following the waterfall method, we specify almost all of the requirements. In an ideal world, we would specify all of the requirements. That's the idea of the waterfall method. So we specify all of the requirements in the beginning, and then none for the rest of the project. But what about knowledge? What about our knowledge surrounding what the customer wants? What we actually can deliver? What we actually can do? What the customer should want? What the market wants? And so forth and so forth and so forth. That knowledge is lowest in the beginning of the project, at the start of the project. And as we run the project, as we do things, as we learn more, our knowledge increases and increases and increases. Whether it increases linearly or exponentially is besides the point. This is an abstract visualization. But the point is, we specify all of the requirements when we know almost nothing. But over time, our knowledge grows. So this is entirely backwards. We should be able to specify requirements when we know more. So this is an argument in favor of iteration. But you might stop and say, isn't it good to specify all of the requirements up front? Wouldn't it be silly of us to not know the requirements? Of course my customer should know their requirements. If we're a startup, how come we don't know the requirements? Shouldn't we know them? Actually, it's not that simple. Let's move on to explanation number 2. S-type, P-type, and E-type systems. So there's a paper from 1980 written by Manny Lehman called Programs, Life Cycles, and Laws of Software Evolution. The paper suggests that all systems fall into one of three categories. So a system is either an S-type system, a specifiable system, a P-type system, a problem-solving system, or it's an E-type system, an embedded system. And here we don't mean embedded as in embedded into cars and hardware. We mean embedded in the real world. I find that these terms are extremely useful when it comes to trying to determine what kind of thing we're trying to build, to avoid making assumptions about what assumptions we can make. Let me show you what I mean. S-type systems are systems that are fully specifiable. You can specify the problem, logically, and you can specify the solution. So you know when your program satisfies the specification. You know when you are done, and you know when you are right. What are some examples of software like this? Well, sorting algorithms, or mathematical calculations. As you might suspect, most of us are not writing S-type systems. So what about the next category? P-type systems are problems that we can understand but not completely specify. Perhaps we can specify the problem, but we can't specify it to such an extent that we can also specify the solution. The crux here is that P-type systems usually require interpretation, human intervention, in order to determine what is a valuable solution, what is a good solution. It is not possible to strictly specify what is a good solution. So as an example, think about an algorithm that plays chess. Even if we can specify the problem, we can't really specify the acceptance criteria. How good should the chess AI be? Inevitably, there will be some heuristics involved. And inevitably, there will have to be some balancing and weighing and thinking about whether this is an appropriately good AI that plays chess at an appropriate level for the problem that we're trying to achieve. And unless we are talking about an S-type system, this isn't really possible to specify. More systems that we see in real life probably fall into this category of systems. A good example in this day and age is probably LLMs, large language models. So companies fine-tune their LLMs or even censor their LLMs. And all of this is stuff that can't really be specified up front, but we have to actually look at the output of the LLM and as humans interpret and think about whether it is good, valuable, sensible output from the model or whether it is not. This is not specifiable a priori. It's not specifiable beforehand. Okay, what about E-type systems? E-type systems are systems that are embedded in reality. I think the easiest way to understand this is that the act of using the system results in pressure for the system to change. The very fact that we are using the system is what causes the system to have to change. It's embedded in this feedback loop with reality. What are some examples of this? Well, just think about social media platforms. It isn't really possible to specify what the system should do up front, because as we embed the product in reality and we see actual usage, only then will we get feedback in order to figure out what thing we probably actually should have built. So when users are using our systems, the systems have been embedded in their lives, and thus the way they want to live have changed, and thus the way they want to use our systems have changed. It's this feedback loop, right? And so in my mind, if you think about it, almost all systems are E-type systems. Do tell me in the comments if you think that you are actually working on S-type or P-type systems. I'd be really interested to hear about that. But in my mind, I've hardly ever worked on anything that's not an E-type system. So what does this have to do with Waterfall? Well, the argument I'm making is that Waterfall is suitable for S-type systems, because in S-type systems, we can specify the problem and we can specify the solution upfront. So it's okay to go linearly. That's fine. We know where we are going. But if you have P-type systems, it's not as obvious. If you're a bit lenient in what you call Waterfall and you allow some amount of iteration, then yeah, something resembling Waterfall might be suitable for a P-type system. But for E-type systems, we just by definition can't use Waterfall, because the very idea of an E-type system is that we don't know what we should have built before we've actually built it, deployed it, and looked at what actually happened, because we're embedding things in real life. Pretty wild stuff, right? Finally, the third and last explanation, and this model is known as the Stacy Matrix or the Stacy Complexity Model. Wait a minute, I put the labels backwards. Let me just correct this. There we go, sorry about that. On the x-axis, you have certainty of technology, certainty of how we are going to build a thing. So in the very left, we are certain how we are going to build a thing. But in the far right, we don't really know. We are not certain in terms of how we are going to build a thing. We have low technological certainty. What about the y-axis? On the y-axis, we have the what, the requirements. What are we going to build? And we're talking about the agreement level surrounding what we are going to build. So in the bottom here, we have high agreement around what we're going to build. But in the top, we have almost no agreement around what we're going to build. We don't know what we are going to build. So on X, you have how, and on Y, you have what. And what is this model trying to show? Well, if you think about this space, as you're moving from the bottom left upwards to the top right, you are moving from certainty in technology and agreement in requirements towards uncertainty in technology and disagreement in requirements. So that means in the bottom left corner, you can use predictive planning, because it's predictable, because you know how you're going to build it and you know what you're going to build. But as you're moving upwards, you have to move away from predictive planning and towards adaptive planning, because you have to adapt to the things that you discover along the way. Because here we have low certainty in how we're going to do it, and we have a low level of agreement in terms of what we're going to build. So usually this space is divided into these four zones. And the four zones are referred to as the simple zone, the complicated zone, the complex zone, and the anarchy zone. In the simple zone, we have known knowns. We know what we need to know, and we know it. We know the questions and we know the answers. In the complicated zone, however, we have known unknowns. We know what we need an answer to, but we don't know the answers. But in the complex zone, we have unknown unknowns. We don't even know what we need to know. And so at this point, you might ask yourself, what is worse than unknown unknowns? Well, in the anarchy zone, you have unknowables. Things just fundamentally can't be known. Okay, here's another way of looking at this. In the simple zone, cause and effect is known. If you consider implementing a feature, then you will know what the effect of implementing that feature is beforehand. But if we move to the complicated zone, cause and effect is discoverable before the fact, meaning that we can figure out cause and effect without having to run an experiment. We can figure it out just by analyzing it. So if you're about to implement a feature, you can figure out what the effect of that feature will be beforehand without having to implement the feature. Think about it like this. If we present a model of the feature to our customers, they will be able to tell us whether the feature will be good or not beforehand. Or in terms of technology, we can figure out how to solve the problem by analyzing the problem beforehand. But in the complex zone, cause and effect is only discoverable after the fact. We can only figure out the cause and effect relationship by actually running an experiment. So we can't figure out the effect of implementing a particular feature beforehand. We have to implement the feature and put it in the world and then analyze the result. Only then will we know cause and effect. Think about it like this. We have to show the feature to the customers in order to figure out whether they actually think it's good. Or technologically, we can only figure out how to solve the problem by actually trying to solve the problem. Okay, and what about the anarchy zone? In the anarchy zone, there is no obvious cause and effect at all. Cause and effect is in flux and can change all the time. So think about it like this. Customer demands are always changing. And in terms of technology, the technological environment that we're operating in is always changing. So there is no obvious cause and effect. So okay, so what's the argument here in terms of waterfall? Usually, we argue that waterfall is only suitable for projects in the simple zone. Iterative methods, however, are suitable in the complicated and in the complex zone. And if you think of your problem as being up in the anarchy zone, then you need something that iterates at a higher level of abstraction, such as lean startup. I hope that these three models have helped you understand why and when the waterfall method doesn't work. Please do share your own thoughts and experiences in the comments. We all appreciate it very much. Subscribe.